Would anyone like to lead us in a word of prayer? Okay. Yes, Sid, can you please?
Father, we come to the throne of grace. We thank you for the presence. We thank you for the time you have given us, Lord. We thank you for this day, the hour we are going to spend in the learning of prayer and intercession, Lord. Lord, thank you for this topic. Thank you for the teacher, Lord. Thank you for all the students. Lord, whatever we are going to learn, Lord, let it be, should be spent in the expansion of your kingdom, Lord. Lord, whatever we are learning, Lord, let it be used in glorifying your name, Lord. We give glory to you, God alone. Lord, do us, mold us as in the way you want us to grow, Lord. Lord, whatever we are doing, Lord, let it be used for your kingdom. We thank you for everything. We thank you for the time you have given us. Lord, bless us. Lord, protect us, provide us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Sitkenu. So we were looking at praying for the family. And in the last class, we said that we have spiritual influence over the family, depending on our position in the family. Okay, if we are, like the head of the household, then there is a certain kind of an influence with which comes with that. But any other member as well, you know, as long as we are the believers in the house, there is a spiritual influence. And especially, you know, the husband has spiritual authority, so he can minister through prayer over his wife and over his children. The parents have a great spiritual authority over their children, so they can pray over their lives, and you know, we can see the power of God manifesting. So these are all things that we looked at, and we said that when we pray for people in our household, in our lives, you know, it really strengthens them. God is able to work in line with his promises, and God is also able to protect them against any adversity. So we specifically looked at some prayers which can be prayed for a spouse. We then kind of said that we can pray similar prayers over the lives of children as well. Okay, so this has to do with their spiritual growth. It has to do with their growth in the purposes of God, to declare specific words and promises over their lives, their prophetic destiny, you know, and to bless them, to bless their present, bless their future, and also get into spiritual warfare wherever it is necessary. So this is as much as we have touched upon. So today we will continue from there. Just an additional note here about praying for the salvation of family members, praying for those who may have gone away from God. Okay, so we know that in some of our families, this is the situation where maybe a few of us, you know, we are believers, but there are others who are not yet believers. Now, the encouragement is that, you know, we must continue to pray, continue to pray. If you remember in the book of James, we saw that when we talked about persevering in prayer, we said that there can be two areas where sometimes we struggle being consistent, being constant in our prayers. And one would be the area of healing. It may take longer than we have, really expected, or in the area of seeing a loved one come back to the Lord, it may take longer. So as an encouragement, you know, James has put those scriptures in there of fervent prayer, that we must never give up and we must continue to pray. When we pray, you know, we will see healing and we will see those who are wavered come back to the Lord. So just a word of encouragement there. So now, if there is some such family member who is wavered and rebellious, you know, let's continue to sow the seed of prayer over their lives. I know it's kind of easier when we see positive results, because positive results are like a motivation. We pray for something, and then when you see that, oh wow, you know, this person is responding, you feel like praying more. But what if you don't see any results? It's kind of hard. But you know, that's where our perseverance should come into play, and we must hold on and keep praying keep continuing strong in prayer for these children. Now, there is a scripture in Isaiah 49 verse 25. I'm on page 56 of our notes. It says, "But thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away, and the prey of the terrible be delivered. For I will contend with him who contends with you, and I will save your children." So it's like God promising and saying, even if there is something very strong which is holding a wayward, you know, we're just saying children here, but it could be, you know, any other family member. God is a God who is stronger than that stronghold, and we can trust God to see the release in the life of our loved one, and especially children, because here this scripture, Isaiah 49:25, it's a promise which says, "I will save your children." So as a parent, we've talked about praying in the will of God, isn't it? So this is the will of God, that he wants to save our children. So we can declare it, and we can pray for the person who is away from God. Yeah, so how do we pray for a person who is far away from God, or, you know, in their own deception? So it's some steps, practical steps. We do understand that it is spiritual warfare. Okay, why isn't an individual ready to accept Christ? And this could be happening for a while. Okay, we said earlier that there can be, the evil one trying to prevent them. But at the same time, we also saw how wrong attitudes, which we may have, can also be preventing our prayers from being heard quickly. Now, as long as we have set our attitudes right, we know that we are coming before the Lord with a clean heart. You know, we have forgiven that person, and you know, we are there just to love them and just to see them come back to the Lord. Now, once we have set our attitudes right, you know, we recognize that these external influences over their lives have to be restrained and also removed. Okay, so we engage in spiritual warfare. One of the ways in which we can exercise our authority is by binding, losing, okay, or also casting down everything that is working on the life of this particular individual. So in our prayers, we would go against whatever is working in their lives. Okay, so the prayer would look something like, okay, let's say this person who's away from God is a child or a young person in the family. And the young person has gone into, some kind of a deceptive, a deceptive teaching. Okay, and I'm just saying, God doesn't exist. Okay, so for whatever reason, the child keeps saying, "No, why are you talking about God? God doesn't exist." Now, we do know, like from scripture, that this kind of a mindset, though it may initially be just the thought life, but it can be influenced by demonic spirits, which are keeping that person deceived with that pattern of thinking, where they say, "Okay, God doesn't exist." So it's a spiritual blindness. Okay, it's spirits of deception that are acting upon the mind of this young person. So even if we go to them and we share the gospel, they are not in a place where they can accept it. So what do we have to do first? We have to break the spiritual influence from the enemy. So the spirits of deception are at work here. So we have to come against that. So we would pray something like, "Okay, we bind your influence in the name of Jesus, and we set this child free." So what happens? When we do that, we are kind of restricting these demons from working, and then we go and minister to the person, and their hearts are more open to receiving. Or we might sense that this spiritual influence has completely taken over that young person. So we may have to go into casting out Right? We may go into casting out either a spirit of deception, from their life, or any other spirit which is acting upon their minds. So we have to go against the demonic. Okay? So spiritual warfare becomes important in prayer. It's not just about saying, God, let this person turn to you, let them accept you, let them be saved. You know, those prayers are fine, but spiritual warfare also a component which must be added when we pray for a wayward person. So binding, losing, casting out, right? Any demonic influence, these are things that we must engage in. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4, it says that that Satan blinds the eyes of people, which is why they are not able to receive the gospel. So that blinding the eye, we have to kind of remove that. Then the people will be able to see the truth of God's word. Okay, then moving on. Now cast down every stronghold, argument, reasoning, imagination that contradicts the truth of God's word upon that person's life. How do we do this? You know, we can do this in prayer. If we recognize, okay, these are the thoughts, these are the arguments, these are the reasonings, we can pray something like, okay, we tear it down in Jesus' name. And in addition to that, you know, we may want to seek opportunities where we can speak truth into the person's life. For example, let's say depression, okay, and the individual is so far away from God and they are not willing to receive God, and they constantly keep saying, you know, that I am useless, God doesn't want me anymore. But you speak the truth of God's word into their hearts and say, no, that's not true. God loves you. God values you so much that he gave his only son to die on the cross for you. So what are we doing? You know, we are casting down that argument, that reasoning in the person's life with the truth of God's word, by saying that, no, you are significant, you are valuable, you know, this is what God thinks of you. So we may have to engage with the word and give them the truth of God's word as well. So in prayer, we will cast these things down. In prayer, we can make declarations over their lives. And in a practicality, you know, we go and we minister the truth of God's word over their lives. We can also invite the work of the Holy Spirit. What does the Holy Spirit do? We know in John chapter 16, we read that in the passage verses 7 to 11, that he comes to convict one of sin, righteousness, and judgment. So when we invite the Holy Spirit to work in that person's life, he can, you know, bring them to a place of decision. Okay. Obviously, the person has to respond, but the Holy Spirit will do his work of convicting the person of sin, righteousness, and judgment. Then ask God to draw them to him, because we know Jesus said that, you know, no one can come to me unless the Father draws that person. So we can begin to pray and say, okay, God, draw this person to yourself. And then, you know, we will see God working up in the life of that individual. Now, we can also pray that God will move upon them and bring them to a place of repentance and bring them, you know, to a place where they will realize, they will have the knowledge of the truth, and they will come to their senses and they will realize that so far they have been away from God and that they really need God in their lives. We can continue to pray and ask God to open up their spiritual eyes, because, you know, spiritual truth is perceived spiritually. Okay, so we can pray, okay, God, open up the eyes of their spirit man so that they realize that they need you in their lives. So as we are praying, again, you know, it's a it could be a process where we are praying for an individual in all these ways, and, you know, slowly God is working in that person's life and they are beginning to change. They are beginning to respond to the work of God and come around and submit themselves to God. So in all these ways, you know, we continue to pray, and over and above this, you know, we could continue to pray that God will bring godly connections, that they will come across good people who will minister the word of God into their lives. We could pray, that God will protect them, right, from making wrong decisions, that God will protect them from any harm. God will preserve them, you know, even though they are doing wrong things, that God will preserve them. You know, I'm reminded of the story of a preacher. I heard this testimony. I don't know too much about the preacher. I've heard a couple of his sermons, but I vividly remember his testimony, where as a child, I think he knew about God, and I don't know if he had made a commitment to God and then he went away from God, or whether he was never born again, but he got into drugs. Okay, and his mother was the one who was praying for him for a very, very long time. His name is Steve Hill. I think you would have heard him minister in the Brownsville revival and all that. So Steve Hill, so he shares a story. And I think now he's promoted to glory. He's in heaven. But he talks about how that season of his life, when he was rebellious and he was doing drugs and he was living a very, very evil life, he felt like he just could not get out of it. He was stuck in those patterns of living, and it was so bad that they would do drugs, and the place where he was living, it had syringes, and it was really bad. It was really, really bad. And his mother would cry, like, even if she comes and she sees where he was living and the way he was living, she would really cry out to God, call out to God and say, God, you encounter my son, you bring him back to your ways. So his mother persevered in prayer, and he kind of shared his testimony how she stood in faith for such a long time, and even though he had gone so far away from God, God brought him to that place of encounter. God brought him to that place of a change of heart. And obviously we know later on he became one of those wonderful preachers of the Brownsville revival. And many, many people, gave their lives to Christ. And that's his story. But the perseverance of his mother, how he was pulled out of that wavered lifestyle, that is very encouraging. And in our notes here, there is the story of Franklin Graham. I am sure all of us know Billy Graham, such a world-famous evangelist. And we would not think that, one of his children went away from the Lord. But the fact is that among the children of Billy Graham, both of the five children, apparently he wandered so far from God that his life was also similar to what Steve Will kind of described. So he went into smoking. He was totally in rebellion. And he wrote a book called Prodigal and Those Who Love Them. She shares her journey. Yeah, sorry, my connection is a little of praying through for this rebellious son to come back to Christ. Okay, and now we know that he of course he did come back to the Lord, and he is a prominent influential Christian leaders in our world today, and many of you would know that he heads up an international Christian relief program and association called as the Samaritan's Purse, and he has had the privilege of meeting world leaders, presidents across countries and continents, and his life is really a life of an example, okay, in the Christian world today. But it was not always is the case, and he also has written an autobiography called Franklin Graham. So why are we sharing these stories? Just to encourage us, There are people, even in our lives, in our families, maybe our friend circle, or in the church who we are praying for, and we find that they are far away from God. But you know, as long as we are committed to praying for them, praying them through, right? This journey of wandering, I'm sure we will see a breakthrough. Okay, so that is, those are some keys to praying for somebody who has gone away from God. So I think I'll just pause here and check with us if you have any additional thoughts. Or okay, John, when we pray for others, we know that we don't pray to change someone's will. Yeah. When we are praying for a family with relationship issues, if one person is not willing to talk, how should we pray about that? Okay. Okay. Yeah, correct. Yes. Okay. So, yeah. So, see, John, obviously, a person's will is very clear in scripture. So even God does not override a human being's will. But when it comes to prayer, and we said that spiritual influence can be, we can have spiritual influence, okay? So based on the word of God, if we pray prayers like, you know, let's say you want reconciliation in a difficult relationship, family relationship, it's a godly thing, because scriptures say that God commands a blessing where there is unity, Psalm 133. So there's nothing wrong. You're not trying to manipulate your family member when you pray for unity, because you're praying in line with God's will. So what is the kind of influence that you are exercising? It's not manipulation, but basically you're declaring the word, and you know that that is supposed to be the normal. Okay, and that prayer can obviously, like, the Holy Spirit can soften the person's heart for us. Now what that person does with the ministry of the Holy Spirit, that we cannot change. That is that individual's decision. So what I'm coming to say is, I'm saying you pull out all the scriptures that talk about how things should be, you know, in peace, kind of mutual respect, communication. You pull out all those scriptures and you begin praying over that person. Okay. And even if that person is not talking, I think it's okay. You can keep praying, because through the word, the power of the word, right, that will work. And also the Holy Spirit will work in that person's life. Now, whether that person responds or they don't respond, that's up to them. We cannot predict the outcome, but we can do our part. If that person's not talking, even then I think we can pray, John. But we'll have to wait to see how that person actually responds.
Okay? Yeah, thank you.
So that's how we would address it in prayer. And if this is a situation where practically you can do something. Let's say, I'm just giving one example. Let's say it's a sibling, okay? And that person is not talking to us. Now, if it's possible, we definitely can involve our parents and say, so-and-so is not talking, but I want to be friends. Can you please talk? Can you please find out? So, even practically, there are ways of approaching healing that relationship. So prayer is one. And depending on what that relationship is and what resolution needs to come in, you can approach it practically also. So that's also there. Yeah. Yeah. So now extending this, just extending what John has said here. Now let's imagine, in a marriage relationship, okay, if there are like communication issues and, things are not right between the husband and the wife, a lot of prayer is going on, a lot of declaration of the word is going on. That's great. Keep that up. But in addition to that, there's nothing wrong in seeking external help. Okay. So by that, I mean, maybe you would want to have some counseling from the pastor or whoever the pastor recommends, right? So that way, we are engaging in two ways. It's like a two-pronged approach. Prayer is there, but there's also a practical way of resolving the matter, and both help. So, I mean, it's also, you know, we should be wise, right? So we can be practical. So yes, please pray, but there's no harm in seeking support externally as well. So I just want to add that thought for us. Sure. Thank you. Right. Okay. Anything else, everyone? Praying for people who have wandered away from God. Okay, so yeah, just for us to know that we pray, but we also engage in spiritual warfare. So it's going to take both, okay, for us to minister in prayer to a family member who is away from God. Now let's move on. Let's move on to how we can pray for our home. As we've been saying, we go by the word of God, okay? We go by what scripture has already promised us, and then we, you know, take that into our prayer, and you know, we declare it and we say, okay, God, this is what is supposed to be normal. So I am speaking that over my family, over my household, and I want to see it happen. So in our notes here, there are a couple of scriptures that have been enlisted. We can use the same for our prayer as well. It says there's rejoicing and salvation in the tents of the righteous. Okay, so we can pray for our homes, for our families, and we can say, God, you know, I declare that there is rejoicing, there is salvation in my family in the name of Jesus. Okay, and as you begin to pray and declare, why do we make declarations? You know, declarations, you're releasing your faith. How do we release our faith? If you believe, what did Jesus say? Mark 11:23, look at the mountain, speak to that mountain, right? Be removed, cast into the sea. So you speak. When we speak, what happens? We're releasing our faith. So when we pray over our households and our families, we can take scripture. We can take the promises of God and say, God, your word says there will be rejoicing. There will be salvation in my home because, you know, we have been made the righteousness of Christ Jesus. So you hold on to scriptures like this. There are scriptures that say that, you know, that God blesses the home of the just. So my home is blessed. When I pray and I say, I declare, my home is blessed. I'm speaking the truth of God's word over my family. My home is blessed because the home of the righteous is blessed. The home of the righteous will stand. Okay. That's another declaration. The tent of the righteous will flourish. There will be, we dwell God's people in Isaiah 32 verses 18 and 19. It says that God's people will dwell in peaceful habitation, in secure dwellings, in quiet resting places. Okay, so now maybe in our homes, this is not the case. You know, instead of rejoicing, maybe there are quarrels going on. Instead of peace, maybe there's a lot of confusion and turmoil. No, instead of security, maybe there are all kinds of you know, issues and struggles and opposition that is coming through. But you know, we can continue to declare God's word over our families and say, God, but your word promises us that we will live in secure dwelling places, in peaceful habitations, in quiet resting places. I claim it in Jesus' name. I speak that over my family in the name of Jesus. Okay, so in this way, we can pray over our household. We can pray over our home. Okay, so I just want to tell you, like, these are things that even I didn't know, frankly, and it was only several years ago when I came across these scriptures that I took it seriously, and I just began to pray, because you know, there were a couple of things that were going on in terms of, you know, the health of my family members, which was a huge struggle for us. And so at one point it felt like, you know, so sick, one of my family members was very sick, and it never felt peaceful to come home. It was always like very burdensome to come home. And this particular scripture, Isaiah 32, I remember just declaring it and saying it, Lord, when I come back to my house, you said, Lord, that your people will dwell in quiet resting places. I don't find it restful at all, but I trust your word. I declare your word. My home is a quiet resting place. My home is a peaceful habitation in the name of Jesus. So in this way, right, we can pray over our families, over our homes, over our you know, household, and you know, we will begin to see that unfold. And frankly, from that point on till now, I have seen a lot of changes, you know, that has taken place. Not to say that, you know, sickness is not yet not there, but the peace of God is there in the midst of you know, some of the challenges. So we must hold on to God's word, and whatever God's word speaks to us is the truth. And it's a battle, really. So when we are ministering in prayer for our family, what are we doing? We're serving in prayer, right? And we are using our spiritual influence. So don't back down. Stand, stay put. No matter what the circumstance looks like, pray over, you know, the spouse, pray over the children, pray over the family, pray over the wandered and the rebellious family member. And God is faithful. You know, he hears our every cry. The earnest prayer of a righteous man avails much, James writes. So we must trust God and persevere in prayer. Okay, there are some prayers and declarations given here for children. I think these are things that, you know, scriptures that you could go through maybe even later. I'll just touch on it. Some passages that are here, that children are a blessing. Okay, so you can declare that over the children of the house. I know some parents usually, you know, they would say things like, oh, such a handful, these kids always being naughty and creating trouble for us every day, right? But no matter how naughty the kids are, the word of God, what does it say? They are a blessing. So even when they are naughty, you can declare it over them and say, hey, you are a blessing. You are a blessing to me from the Lord. Then there are scriptures where God says, a righteous man, okay, a man who honors the Lord, a good man's children will be powerful in the land. His descendants will be blessed. So you can pray prayers. My children will be powerful in the land. My children will be blessed. Right? This is in Psalm 112. It says his family will be wealthy and rich, and he will be prosperous forever. So we hold on to all these passages and say, God, you know, you will bless my children. You will strengthen them. They will be mighty in the land. They are a blessing. Psalm 127 about children, it says children are a heritage from the Lord. They are the fruit of the womb, which is a reward. They are like arrows in the hand of the warrior. So are the children of one's youth. So you declare this over the children and say, "They, my children are a heritage from the Lord. They are a reward of the womb. They are like arrows in my hands." And you know, just bless them. There's one more scripture here from Isaiah 8:18. It says, "We are for signs and wonders in Israel, so that I and the children whom the Lord has given me, we are for signs and wonders in Israel." So, you know, parents can speak this over their kids and say, God, me and my children, we are for signs and wonders at a time such as this. So, you know, there are several scriptures. It's just a small effort which we have to make to go pull out these passages. And when we are praying over the children, you know, can go ahead and declare such passages over them. And basically, you're sowing the word regularly, you're sowing the word over their lives. Okay, so yeah, again, I'm going to pause at this point. Any comments? Any questions? We talked about praying for the family, praying for children. Has anyone been doing something like this already? Have you already been declaring scriptures? Okay, Ribika has a, okay, yeah. Ribika has posted, ma'am, Jesus given the authority to their children and we use that authority in prayer for others and cast out all the demonic spirits in healing prayer. Okay, Ribika, I'm wondering what your question is in this statement.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, yeah. Jesus has given the authority to their disciples and he said that and go the place and pray in the name of Jesus, and because Jesus, Father, Lord has given the authority to all you and cast out all the demonic spirit like that, ma'am, that Jesus has given the in children also, that we also means cast out the demonic spirit in the authority of, in the name of Jesus, like that.
Okay, so Ribika, you're asking me, can a child cast out demons?
No, ma'am. Spirituality people. They can.
Any believer.
Out, yes. They can, yes, cast Ribika. Out the spirit.
Yes. Anyone. Okay. See, I'll give you one verse. One second. I'll just copy paste it over here. Mark 16. Yeah. Okay. Mark 16, verse 17 through 18. Okay. See, this passage, it says, these signs shall follow them that believe. Who? Anybody who believes. So, even a normal believer can. What shall they do? In my name shall they cast out devils. So, any believer, can they cast out devils? It says no. Anybody who believes, you can do it. And of course, the other things there. So, does it clarify, Ribika?
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Yes, I'm all right.
Great. Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. Yes, Asit Kenu, I can see your hand is raised. Please go ahead.
Ma'am, when you were teaching about praying for the family, I just remember an incident which happened in my family. If you allow, can I share it?
Yeah. Sure. Most welcome. You can share.
Ma'am, in 2015, what happened with my grandfather, actually, he was coming from somewhere and accidentally he fainted. So we took him to the doctor and the doctor told that you should go through an x-ray. When we did the x-ray, that in his intestine, we found that cancer. He is having a cancer. He was suffering from the cancer. So he was in fourth stage of cancer. So all our family was worried, but he was not worried. And my grandmother, being a praying woman, and my grandfather is the pastor of our church. So what we did, my mother and all our church decided that he is in hospital. So what we will do, we will intercede for him. We read Psalms 91 times. Each and every day, we used to read Psalms 91 times. And my grandfather, when he was operated, after that, doctor told to do an x-ray one more time. When we did the x-ray, doctor was shocked that in intestine, there was no sign of cancer. Before it was in the report, it is written that this fellow person is cancer positive. But after intercession prayer, we did prayer for 4 hours non-stop. We were reading Psalms 91 times. But after that, the 4 hours, my grandfather's operation was going on. And after that, the operation, when the report again came, it says that this person is not cancer.
Wow.
The cancer came negative.
Praise God. Thank you, Sitkenu. Thank you so much for sharing. That's miraculous, astonishing. And we know that we serve a God who works miracles. And particularly when we pray, right? We pray. And amazing, how you all of you also engaged in prayer. I'm so thrilled that you're sharing this because in another class today, we discussed about how the church prayed for Peter. Peter was in the prison in Acts chapter 12 and the believers prayed together for Peter, and then, you know, the miracle happens. The angel comes, the chains are broken, he's led out of the prison. He's under very high security, but he's led out of all that to an iron gate, and the iron gate opens on its own. You know, the crazy stuff. Like, if you watch a movie, then you'll be like, wow, this is amazing. But it's in real life. It happened in Peter's life. And he's brought to the house of a believer, where all the other believers are gathered together. They are praying, they're interceding for the release of Peter, and it actually happens. So, you know, there is so much power in prayer when we engage, right? And today, yeah, we are also talking about how we must pray for our family members. Thank you so much, Sitkenu. Blessed to hear that wonderful testimony. We praise God for what has happened, in your grandfather's life. And here in the chat, I'm just looking at, okay, Divya says, promise versus given by God during the kid's birth. We do declare over children. Okay. And Isaiah 54:13, is that your children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be their peace.
Yes.
Amen. Yes, true. Isaiah 54:13. Yes, that's true. Praise God. Yeah. So, yes, and some of you also posted on the chat saying you do pray scriptures, you do declare scriptures over your family, over your children. That's a great habit. Please continue doing that. And you know, honestly, like, I am just sharing with you, I did not know that you can do something like this, but it's only later that I kind of picked up, using scriptures in my prayer and standing on God's word for family members, for home, and it's something that I have learned and I continue to do. So if you are somebody, you have never done that before, then try to incorporate that, because it's really powerful. Yeah, so sure. Any other comments, thoughts about praying for family, praying for somebody who's gone astray?
Can I share
something? Yes, Divya. Yes, please. Yes.
Yeah, so this is about, we have moms groups here, right? So which we would meet once in a week or so, and we would be, either going through like a book, like we are doing like Power of a Praying Mom. That's by Swami Amarshit.
Yeah.
So, it's really encouraging, because you're talking with other mothers, and they are sharing their struggles, and even get to know how they are coping up with different challenges that we are seeing in their kids. So it's really encouraging, as well as we are upholding each other's kids in prayers. I would be praying for the other the mother's children. So I would say it's really helpful, and I would really encourage anyone if it is something that is possible. Yeah.
Yeah, as well, that you've joined with, who are praying for the children. Okay, nothing like it. It's so empowering. So while preparing for this particular subject, as I was looking up, how waywardness about how people have prayed for those who have gone away from the Lord. No, I found a lot of resources from mothers and mothers of teenagers, mothers of young adults who. Somehow, when the kids were young, they started making these declarations, but they continued it through those difficult years, right? And even though it seemed for a while that the children are going away from God, how they kept praying and how they kept, encouraging themselves, and how the Lord brought the children back, on track, and you know, mighty testimonies, so many testimonies of mothers, parents praying for their children. So I think it's a good thing to kind of start doing it early and keep praying for the children, no matter what happens. Even if they sidetrack a little bit, we know that, you know, God is faithful to his word. God is faithful to answer the prayers of parents. So yes, it's important. And thank you, Divya, for that encouragement. Sure. Right. So anything with regard to praying for the family or the house? Any comments, thoughts?
I just have a question.
Yes, Divya.
So even I do this, but I have seen people, you know, saying, I plead the blood of Jesus Christ, you know, upon my family. So what is the, it's used so widely that sometimes, you know, you don't even understand why you're saying that. So I just wanted to know, like, is it good to pray that way? Is it biblical? And why do people pray that?
Yeah, sure, Divya. Good question. I'll just give you a scripture. Okay, so this is in Revelation 12 and verse 11. I'm posting it. Okay, it says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. It's talking about the believers who will live during the tribulation, and one of the weapons which they will use to overcome the Antichrist and his oppression is the blood of the Lamb. So it tells us that the blood of the Lamb, it's a spiritual weapon which we have. Okay, now how do we use this weapon? The way we use the blood of the Lamb is to recognize what the blood of the Lamb has done for us. So we know, you know, it speaks a better thing than the blood of Abel. It speaks of our forgiveness, it speaks of our redemption, right? It speaks of the atonement. So the blood of Jesus, the moment you declare what the blood has done, when you understand what the blood has done, the enemy shudders, because he knows that you know. Okay? So the best way of using the weapon of the blood of Jesus is to declare, understand and declare what it has done for us. Now, we also understand that the blood of Jesus, right, it protects us. It protects us. Now, we can get this from the way the blood of the Passover lamb was used to protect people from the plague that killed the firstborn. So in that same manner, you know, we do understand that the blood of Jesus protects us. Okay, so there is, even though people say it in a sentence like, I plead the blood of Jesus over my family, what they are saying is they're declaring that the blood has the power to protect them from the enemy or from Satan and his demonic schemes. It works. Okay, you're acknowledging the power of the blood, and that's a weapon which we can use against the enemy. So though that way of saying it may not be technically correct, Divya, like I plead the blood, it may not, I mean, you need not say it like that, but it's understood, right? That they are declaring the work that only the blood of Jesus can do for us, which is protect us from Satan.
Okay, all right. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Sure, Divya. So yes, you could declare. And how do you pray in a technically correct way? You just declare what the blood has done for us. You know, we are redeemed by the blood. We're protected by the blood. So when we make those declarations, you're using the power of the weapon, which is the blood of Jesus, over yourself, over your family, and it releases the power. Okay, so yeah, so these are all ways in which we can engage in prayer, and I really encourage all of us, you know, make a list of the scriptures and then go ahead, start declaring it, start speaking it over your life. Those of you who are not married, please don't get upset. You can declare it over your future home. You can declare it over your future children, declare it over your future spouse. Okay, so we'll just close today's time with a word of prayer. Just want to request somebody to pray, please, and wrap up today's session. Who would like to pray? Subhashish, can I request you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Loving Father, once again, Lord, we thank you so much for this beautiful day, Lord. Thank you for speaking to us, Lord, throughout this morning. And Lord, I thank you for our dear sister, Lord, as from the word, Lord, always, Lord, she is encouraging, teaching, Lord, and especially pray that you bless us, that we can pray honestly for us, for our family, for our children, even the future children, Lord. I especially pray for all our dear ones, Lord, those who are here and those who are late also. May bless them, Master. The things, Lord, we are learning, Lord, you help us to implement it in our life, Master, in the ministry, Master. We thank you, Jesus. Continuously bless us. Speak to us, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Subhashish. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. It's a good time. Blessed time. Yeah. You take care. We'll thank meet you, again ma'am. Tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you, brother. Bye. Bye. God bless you all. Bye.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye. God bless you.